of the meeting tonight is to continue a review of the notice of intention for the proposed City of Seattle annexation of North Highline Area Y. At the conclusion of tonight's session, the Boundary Review Board will determine whether it's necessary to extend the hearing to June 16th. With that, I will go to roll call.
Sylvia Bushnell.
Here.
Mary Lynn Evans.
Here.
Jay Hamlin.
Here.
Claudia Hershey.
Here.
Laura Casalius.
Here.
Ron Little.
Here.
Paul McCready.
Here.
Jim Polhamus.
Here.
Stephen Toy.
Here.
Excused tonight is Evangeline Anderson, and recused is Miguel Beltran. Also sitting to my right is Robert Kaufman, who's the Attorney General for the board, and I am Lenora Blaum, and I'm the executive.
Okay, this public hearing has come to order tonight, and I will go straight to the question of board members at this time. If there are board members who have a conflict of interest, such as a personal interest or professional involvement, which might affect your ability or the perception of your ability to fairly hear this proposal at this time, will you please so indicate for the record? Has any of the board members had any ex parte communication with any interested party while this matter has been before us? If so, please disclose that information now. And if anyone present in the audience has reason to question the ability of any board member to hear and judge fairly under the doctrine of appearance and fairness, please say so now. We'll move on to the process as described by the legal counsel.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm going to briefly review the procedure we're going to be following this evening. Most of you were here last night, and I've heard this, some of you were not here, but I'm going to do the Cliff's Notes version now of the rules so we can get right into the hearing. The purpose of this hearing is to hear from everyone on this matter who wants to be heard. So if there's anyone in the room that has not, who wishes to testify, who has not signed up, there is a list at the table out by the entrance to the room. We ask that you please sign up. To be most effective and perhaps persuasive in your testimony, we ask that your comments try to focus on the factors that the Boundary Review Board is to consider in reaching its decisions, as well as the objectives that the board's decisions are intended to advance. All of those factors and objectives are on the back on the reverse page of the agendas that some of you may have, and if you don't have one, there is a stack of them over by the table where you sign up to testify. We do ask you that, while we welcome your testimony, we don't wish to limit anyone's testimony. I will say if a prior witness has said something that you agree with or something that you would have said yourself, please come forward and tell us that. You're free to tell us whatever you want the board to know, but if it's already been said, it might be more efficient to indicate that you agree with the prior speaker. There are some time limits. Some of this is moot because many of the governmental speakers have already gone ahead. The City of Seattle, as the proponent, was allotted 20 minutes. King County was allotted 15 minutes. Other governmental units and recognized groups have 10 minutes to speak, and individuals who wish to speak will have a 3-minute time limit. The Boundary Review Board's administrative assistant and delegate Vasquez, will be keeping time. She will hold up a 1-minute warning sign, which is a bright orange sign, to let you know that 1 minute is up. We ask that you kind of keep an eye out for that sign. So that when you see it come up, we ask that you start to wrap up your comments. Excuse me. Only the board members may ask questions of the witnesses. If the board members have any questions of the witnesses, the time that a witness takes to answer those questions will not be counted against that witness's time. Because this is what we characterize as a quasi-judicial proceeding, we are going to conduct ourselves to the extent possible as if we were in a courtroom. And what that would mean is that we allow the witnesses to testify without any hostility or support. If you agree with what a speaker says, that's great, but please don't voice it. If you disagree with what a speaker says, that's your right as well, but please don't voice that as well. And the board may have questions of law that it would refer to me. After everyone has testified who wishes to be heard, the proponent of the City of Seattle will have 10 minutes to do a rebuttal. The purpose of the city's rebuttal is not to present its case anew, but to respond to the points that some of the other witnesses and governmental units have made. Following, when the hearing is closed, the Boundary Review Board, let me back up a minute. After the board determines to close the public hearing, then it will proceed with its deliberations. When the board does that, you're going to hear a motion and a second and a vote to close the public hearing. When the board approves that, that does not mean that we're asking anyone to leave, because the next step after the public hearing is closed is for the board to conduct its deliberations. Those deliberations are a public process, and we welcome everyone who wants to stay and observe those deliberations to do so. So just because you hear a motion pass that the public hearing is closed, that doesn't mean that the board isn't going to continue to review this matter and deliberate. After the board conducts its deliberations, it will instruct staff to prepare a written resolution and hearing decision. Those instructions to the board staff made by the board members are not board action. Board action can only be taken upon the adoption of a written resolution and hearing decision. And depending upon the timing of this public hearing, whether we finish this evening and when, or whether we finish Thursday, that will determine when the board deliberates, when the staff is asked to prepare the resolution and hearing decision, and when that resolution and hearing decision will be presented to the board. And we will keep you advised of that every step of the way. If you have any exhibits that you would like the board to consider, we ask that you present them to Ms. Velasquez, that she will mark those. Exhibits will be retained by the board throughout this proceeding. They will be retained by the board throughout the 30-day appeal period that follows the board's adoption of its hearing. If there is no appeal following the expiration of the 30-day appeal period, those exhibits will be available for return. If after the board acts and if there is an appeal to the Superior Court, those exhibits go to the Superior Court. If it goes beyond that, they may go to the Court of Appeals. So in other words, if there is any litigation following this, you may not see your exhibits again for a very long time, if at all. So please don't submit original exhibits that you may want back. Copies are just fine. Everything that's being said during the course of this public hearing is being recorded verbatim. Copies of transcripts are available for purchase, and if you're interested, Ms. Velasquez can help you with that. That having been said, for those of you who are going to testify, I'll ask you to please stand if you're able. If you've already been sworn, you don't need to be sworn again. And I'll ask you to raise your right hand if you're able. Do each of you swear or affirm that the testimony you'll give this evening will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Thank you very much. Please be seated.
Last evening, we completed all of the testimony from government agencies and began general testimony. We were not able to complete that. I have two lists here with probably about 15 people on them, so I will start to call you. I will call you one at a time, but I'll also call two names behind you so that people can prepare to testify. A general reminder that if you're representing yourself, it's 3 minutes. If you're representing a community group, you have 10 minutes. If the board is going to ask you questions, that does not apply to your assigned time. Mike Mullen, Barbara Dotkin, and Scott Davis. Would you please give us your name and your address, and then we'll be happy to listen to your question.
Mike Mullins, 118 Southwest 116th Street, and I'm the president of Autobus Condominiums,
listening to the City of Seattle's presentation last night, I had a few questions. First of all, if this annexation goes through, what is the plan of action as far as implementing all these programs that would be available to the citizens of this community? They talked about the uniquely able to provide services, but I'm wondering how we would access them, if we will have a representative with the city who will take charge of this program and offer it to us and contact the communities and let them know how to access the services available. And then, for example, the Office of Economic Development. That's a very important aspect of our community, something that we haven't been able to get much results from. And I hope that that would be something that they would reach out to us and provide information on and how to develop that certain area. Also, in terms of the police services, we have quite a bit of crime going on in this area at certain times. It's grown over the years, and the Sheriff's Department hasn't been able to really keep on top of it. But the police department, from what I can tell, in certain areas of Seattle, hasn't been able to control it in those areas either. So how will we know that they will be able to help us? They talk about six deputies or six officers on duty at all times. And so we wonder, is that actually going to make a change here? Also, operational issues. That was something that was brought up last night when we were asked about fire department and other services, and that was said to be an operational issue that would be dealt with at a later time. We want to know what the time frame is. So basically, I would like to know more details, more specifics. There seems to be a lot of smoke and mirrors going on, but I don't see any actual details as to how we would benefit from being annexed to Seattle. Thank you.
Any questions for board members?
Investment in lower income, moderate income communities, ethnically diverse communities. And also, how can Seattle and King County even begin to justify, this is my words now, the annexation of North Highline will improve our lives and our services when there are over 300 people living under I-5 in the area known as the jungle, when there are people camped out all over the International District on sidewalks at Lake City and in Ballard, and as you heard last night on along Myers Way, adjacent to our North Highline community. The city is clearly facing a crisis, yet they want us in North Highline to think they can come and improve our lives, and that leaves big questions. I just want to end with the board received a letter from Liz Skiba in opposition to the annexation, and I want to get on the record that the North Highline Unincorporated Area Council endorses that letter. Thank you.
Any questions?
Scott Davis, Elizabeth Gordon, and Diana Van Winkle. Elizabeth Gordon.
And he has shared it with Kenny Pittman. If annexed into Seattle, residents would continue to pay the capital bond levy for King County Library services until it was paid off in 2024. They would no longer pay the King County Library Services operations levy. Currently, King County Library Services collects approximately $624,000 in revenue for the library operations levy from the homes in the potential annexation area. If annexed into Seattle, we would no longer be able to collect this revenue. We estimate the direct operating costs of the White Center Library at $1.1 million and the Greenbridge Library at $400,000 for a total of $1.5 million. This includes staff salaries, benefits, supplies, leases, utilities, building maintenance, and collections. It does not include administrative shared costs such as human resources, IT, and marketing. The primary intention is to ensure that residents continue to have seamless access to library services regardless of what the future holds. This can be done in two ways. King County Library Services transfers the two libraries in the annexed area to the City of Seattle to be operated by the Seattle Public Library. This agreement would need to be negotiated and approved by both parties to determine what assets are retained and what assets are transferred. The land is technically owned by the state, so we do not have the right to transfer that asset. We would need to discuss this with the state. The collection would likely not be transferred as it is part of the larger system as a whole and is collectively purchased by the taxpayers in other parts of the county. King County Library Services continues to operate with two libraries. This is the second option. The two libraries in the annexed area for a determined amount of time, with the City of Seattle paying King County Library Services the amount of lost tax revenue, as described above, $624,000 per year. This agreement would need to be negotiated and approved by both parties with a contract specifying the exact expectations and terms. Gary A. Watson, Library Director, King County Library System. And I can leave this with you. Okay, and now comments from the White Center Chamber of Commerce, for which I am the secretary. And just up front, I will say that the chamber supports the position of the sewer district and that the library district stay with King County, the libraries stay with King County operations, and support the concerns raised by Liz Giba, and also those of North Highline Unincorporated Area Council regarding concerns of outreach and economic development. And our big concern is, would we be paying more for the same or less services? We would have extra costs because of business licenses, there's the minimum wage and paid leave, those kinds of issues. But really, it's not, as the prior speaker said, it's not clearly how things will be operationalized. And I would say overall, there is, what the big issue is trust. What's being said, is there going to be follow through? This area has not had economic development for over 20 years, an economic development plan. We were number one in the priority for King County in their plan that they've come up with now. Unless Seattle is going to annex us, then we fall to lowest priority. However, that means that there's a 2 to 3 year stretch added onto that 20 years where there is still no more economic development because Seattle is considering annexing us. We, when I spoke before at this board, we had suggested that Seattle and King County be required to consider economic development in this area and planning for this area, and that Seattle, as a goodwill gesture, start to put forth some efforts in that direction. We haven't seen that yet. I guess part of those trust issues also is, by way of example, there was some infrastructure redone on the Seattle side of Delridge, just north of Roxbury. And that was to help traffic flow. And the problem is that it didn't take into consideration that there is now a 48-unit building being built right there, and that the traffic is already backed up at the stop sign in the morning, that you can't go through the intersection smoothly, continue across. And they blocked off the road and shut off the businesses that were there. These are small mom-and-pop businesses, and there was no information that the road was going to be closed for, it was for several weeks, except that somebody handed out a flyer. And it's that kind of lack of engagement, lack of effective outreach and discussion that is problematic for us. And it would be one thing if part of this proposal was, yes, there was going to be somebody at the county and the city, they're going to sit down, they're going to listen, it's going to be real. And with all due respect to Kenny Pittman and Karen Freeman, we don't see them that often to have established an enduring kind of relationship with them in that manner. They are spokespeople, and so we need something a little more concrete. We need people who understand the needs of businesses and the need to have predictability in planning. There is... the other issue that is there is the marijuana licensing of businesses in the area. Seattle has regulated, it's been very proactive in that regard. However, when it comes to the boundary with North Highline, they put a pot shop, retail store, right there by a bus shelter. And the people who are running it have taken on marketing strategies that seem to be opposed to the public interest. I myself am the administrator at a retail recreational store. The first one that came from within White Center. We're very involved with the community. We hire locally. We do staff development. And we are very aware of the need for youth prevention and responsible adult use. We are engaged. What has happened is that there are none other retail licenses that have been approved. This is for an area with a population of 17,000. So you have a total of 11 in this area, whereas for Redmond and Kirkland, which has a combined population of 150,000, they are only allowed 8 licenses. So how is this going to be dealt with? This needs to be laid out. And I can tell you, in a startup industry like this one, predictability is very, very essential to being able to continue to run your business in a responsible way. So we need that kind of information to the other businesses in the area. We need that information as well. Then also the homeless camp, the encampment in Myers Way that was raised. The transient and public inebriation has long been an issue. One of the concerns, however, with the encampment up Myers Way is that the encampment is on the Seattle side. However, the petty crimes that take place are on the North Highline side. And as far as we know right now, there is no coordination between law enforcement there. And it's difficult because of the policy directives the Seattle police have received in dealing with the situation. I would like to conclude by saying that the chamber acknowledges that this area has higher poverty rate, the highest in the county. And we understand that that is about 25%. We would like assurances that there is going to be integrated housing development, integrated economic development, so that poverty rate does not rise any higher. It is very difficult to maintain a business if people do not have, if there are not consumers in the area. We'd like to see Technology Access Foundation. There could be more high tech in this area. There could be a number of different options that people have, and those all need to be considered. But I would say at the bottom, we want to be engaged. We want to be engaged with zoning discussions. How are all these police that are supposed to come in here be paid after the 7 years of the tax credits? Is that off developers' fees and permits? What is that going to look like? We want to know, we want to be engaged, we want to be asked to be at the table. Thank you.
We have questions?
Yes, yeah.
Ms. Evans?
Ms. Gordon?
Yeah.
I don't remember, or perhaps I don't know which sewer district.
I can't hear, I'm sorry.
I can't hear.
Oh, sure.
I don't know which sewer district that you said early on in your testimony that you supported the sewer district. Which one was it, and do you remember specifically what it was that you supported?
I believe it's 49 and 19. There's two of them.
No, 49 is 20 of water.
The president, Bobby Beeman, wasn't able to be here tonight, and he had these discussions, and so I'm afraid I have miscommunicated it.
I'm a commissioner for Southwest Suburban. So it's easier here. It is Southwest Suburban.
Excuse me. The question is directed to the
Oh, it's Southwest Suburban Sewer District.
Thank you.
And then I have another question. Did the White Center Chamber of Commerce ever take a vote, yes or no, for annexation? I heard your concerns.
Right. We did, our membership has mixed views, but all of us believe that these concerns need to be addressed before the process continues. So we would say, we would request, we would either oppose it or request a delay until these concerns can be met. Thank you.
Any other questions?
Diana Van Winkle. Angela Benedetti. Pat Murakami. And Amanda K. Tomek.
Angelina Benedetti, West Region, King County Library System Manager. I was to read the statement from Gary Watson into the record, which was just read. So I will step down. Thank you.
Question from Mr. Little.
I did have a question. I was curious, that first comment, if they've annexed to Seattle residents, we continue to pay the capital bond levy for KCLS until it's paid off in 2024. Now, when they built the library in my neighborhood, I don't remember if they had a special assessment to build the library. It's just the general tax over them.
There was a special capital bond levy that was approved by voters in 2004 for the whole library district, and it was for capital improvements throughout the entire district.
Okay, and so that would stay on this area, even though if they annexed it?
That is correct. Yeah, because it was originally voted by voters in this area as part of that capital bond improvement program. And it's that capital bond improvement program that paid for the
opening of the recent Clark Center Library.
We heard from a resident last night, a retired librarian, that there is no current reciprocal agreement in place between King County and Seattle Public Library. Can you confirm or?
We do have a reciprocal borrowing agreement between the King County Library System and the Seattle Public Library. While I was not here last night, I did hear that there was some reference to the ability to place holds on materials. And that is a borrowing privilege that was recently reestablished in a limited way. Seattle residents can have up to 10 holds on King County Library System materials.
Yep. Any other questions for board members?
Thank you. Pat Murakami. Amanda Helmick.
Hi, my name is Amanda K. Helmick. I live at 9408 23rd Avenue Southwest. That is on the other side, just on the other side of Roxbury in West Seattle. I am very involved in the community, but I am here speaking as just a resident. I have been a co-chair of the Westwood Rock Hill Harbor Heights Community Council for the past 3.5 years. And co-author of the letter that Barbara referenced to you guys earlier about the comp plan 2035. I'm here tonight to talk about objectives about preservation of natural neighborhoods and communities. Number one on your objectives, I'm also here to talk about prevention of abnormally irregular boundaries and the discouragement of multiple incorporation of small cities. White Center is not a separate town, it's not a separate place for people in West Seattle, or Seattle. It is connected. Roxbury has no boundary except that it's a street. Most people don't even realize that unincorporated King County is on the other side. And what I want to talk about is the fact that our community has a problem with connection to the other side. And that's connection in building community. So we are planned stewards for the Westwood Highland Park Urban Village. It's a network, I hope you guys are familiar with that, through the city of Seattle, to concentrate growth in certain areas. And this Westwood Highland Park Urban Village is just on the other side of Roxbury from the downtown West Seattle, or the downtown White Center Business District. So our neighborhood has had pretty much zero capital improvement dollars spent in 20 years of it. But we have reignited that planning process. So on the positive note of the letter that we sent, that we are, as an active community, looking to engage. And we find the annexation of White Center to be a catalyst for that. We want to see joint planning. We want to make sure that when people are voting in White Center on what they're voting for, it can be a plan. There'll be a plan in place that they know what's coming down the road, that it's not just going to be a free-for-all, that, you know, just going to open it up to development. Thank you. And that there will be joint planning together. So I really hope that this board encourages that for Seattle and encourages that for King County to move forward. We are not separate. We are together. And I want that to be the theme moving forward, that it's not us and them, but it's all of us together trying to make this a better community for everyone who lives there. Thank you.
Questions from board members?
I was just wondering, people have expressed concern about their being able to get representation in the city. How has the new forum worked out where you have district election of council members? Has that helped at all?
Well, I might be in a different position than most people. I've been in contact with a lot of government agencies through the years with being on the community council. But when I call Lisa Erbold's office, one of her staff members answers, and they're very knowledgeable. If they don't answer, they call me back right away. They're very responsive with email. Having this new district council has been beneficial so far. We're early into it, but so far it's been a lot better.
I have a question on the, the geographic proximity of the urban village for Westwood Highland Park. And the area that you formerly represented, the Roxbury Community Council, are they? I'm I don't know if you can describe geographically how that the urban village is obviously on the Seattle
it is.
Side.
So the urban village, the boundary is Roxbury to the south, and then to the west, it's 26th Avenue southwest.
26th, okay.
And then to the east, it's 8th Avenue, so right at Greenbridge.
Okay.
And then it kind of zigzags in there. The representation of it, though, is a little bit more expansive. So we'll go up to 35th Avenue southwest, to Holden, and then to 8th. So it's a pretty large area. But the core itself, where we're concentrating that growth, really is kind of that Bell Ridge corridor. We have some businesses along there. The actual Westwood Village Shopping Center, that's included in that as well.
So the urban village boundary does coincide with the southern boundary?
Absolutely. It runs right up to it.
And you're talking about then joint planning eventually for areas to the south with the idea that
we've actually started the process. Our community group has started, and actually with King County, we've had both groups out to our meetings, just starting to get that idea into the heads of, hey, you know, this is a great opportunity, a good opportunity moving forward to have some
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Mr. McCree?
You may or may not be able to answer this question, but just generally speaking, are the community organizations or the councils, the Chamber of Commerce, et cetera, business organizations, do they include both sides of White Center, or is this, or do they tend to be separate? This is just a general question.
I can answer that from my personal perspective.
Right.
I am very inclusive, so when I have my meeting, I always extend an invitation. I'm very involved with the business owners in the White Center side. I have a lot of friends actually doing the businesses, so when there's things going on, I make sure that they're included. Again, I think we're all in this together, so from a community standpoint, I'd say yes, but I can't really answer to Chamber of Commerce or anything like that. There does tend to be some separation. More distance, so the farther south you get, the more distance there is from inclusion.
Thank you.
Rick Kim, Bob Price, and Liz Giba.
My name is Loretta Greencam. I live at 307 Southwest 110th Street in Seattle. I've been a resident in the area for 50 years plus. And I just have a couple comments. If this area does go to Seattle, what happens to us after the legislation money runs out? I don't care if you've got that budget or how things are going to continue, or are we just going to be cut off? And what happens after that? Someone else mentioned the police coverage. We have 2 off shift now and 6. Is that 6 per shift or 6 per what? Seattle can't cover Magnolia or the Pike area or the Pine Street area, and there seems to be a lot of crime. So how is that? They can't handle things in Seattle. How are they going to handle things out here? We don't have a lot of property tax in the area. Coming in, we have Green Bridge, we have Seattle Gardens, we have Unity Village, we have Coronado Springs that are all low income, and so we don't get a lot of property taxes from there, so we don't have a lot of income coming into the area. We need some growth, but we're kind of worried about that. A lot of people don't go downtown shopping anymore, Thanksgiving parade to Christmas shop, or to take visitors even when they come into town, because they don't feel it's safe, because the activities in the core of downtown. Some of the situations that the city council, the decisions they make, I don't know if it's for their good or for the good of the people. The bike share program, that really is a flatter location, but it doesn't seem to, the council seems to think that a hill area will work. Painting the sidewalks, if painting could go onto bridges or fill in potholes, so where they spend their money, it's kind of a worry. They don't seem to have importance of what's important to the rest of the community.
Right.
We have the schools, one of the schools in this area would be Evergreen High School, and it's a track school. It has three schools in one. But a lot of the students there aren't happy with that. Would they be able to transfer into a Seattle school, or could they transfer into a Highline school? The motorhomes are an issue, and that's been mentioned several times, where they are. It seems to be that Seattle seems to be enabling them instead of solving the problem. And a lot of people are saying it's more like a slum city than a nice, evergreen, beautiful city to invite visitors into. So that causes a lot of crime problems. Hans Creek is right above this West Myers Way issue. And so there's a lot of issues with, because of lack of bathrooms or whatever, for the people that are staying up there, how much of this is seeping into the ground and affecting Hans Creek. And I think that's about it. I can support the water and sewer district staying independent and not going into Seattle. They do a good service and they put their money back into the system.
Any questions from the board? Thank you.
Are you in favor of annexation at this point, or are you not?
No.
I live at 109 on 5A, Lancaster Drive, South Seattle. My concern is safety. I'm the crossing guard at the main thoroughfare of Rock Ferry between Seattle and North Highline for 16 years. I have many motor officers working with me as a bus police supervisor. And all that time, we never did come anywhere near getting enough support from the police department where we could handle the speeders. It's a horrible racetrack. I had a lot of people hurt there. We were never able to get any help because they're always short-handed. One of the old patrol officers that I worked with retired shortly, and I asked him how things were. He said they haven't improved hardly at all. He'd been there 32 years. Seattle has a large crime problem in the Delridge area and the South Park area. The South Park area, I know for a fact that the drug dealers and handlers and users have been turned into the Seattle Police Department numerous times. But nothing has been done. Whether they can't do anything or elected not to do anything, I don't know. However, one of the problems was solved a few weeks ago when one of the gentlemen dealing in drugs was shot in a convenience store in our neighborhood when he was trying to rob it with a hatchet. The gentleman carrying the pistol had a permit. He was authorized to carry it, and he saved the lives of the clerk and himself. I think before Seattle needs to take any more jobs on them, they need to take care of what they've got already. I see that the mayor has asked for more police officers. That's fine. But as I understand it from my history, those police officers that he's asked for right now are just filling the void that he already has. It has nothing to do with what's going to happen later. Another problem is the density of the zoning in Seattle. They're going to make your zoning so tight here that population will grow considerably. Our schools will be overcrammed with children, and there'll be more dangerous children in schools. I can't see the police department being able to handle that. So therefore, I'd like to ask you to please delay or advance approve this request until something is done about these items. Thank you.
Questions from the board?
I
sorry, could you talk into the microphone?
One second.
Ma'am, may I hold them for you?
Thank you very much.
Liz, can you get closer to the mic?
How's that?
Let me help. I guess.
We're going to make a group effort. This is quite stunning. Welcome to it. Thank you, sir. First things first. My name is Liz Kiba. I've lived in White Center since 1974. And although I am a commissioner on the North Highline Fire District, I'm not speaking for North Highline Fire. I'm speaking as concerned citizen. Not the last paragraph of the first page of my book. As you reviewed Seattle's notice of intention, I think you found that it does not include a plan. There was no comp plan. There's no current comp plan. Seattle told you that they would have a new comp plan by the end of last year. No comp plan yet. No housing plan yet. Still hasn't been heard by the city council. So they don't really know what they want to do with us. What they have told you in the notice is outdated information. They're telling us that the soonest they will annex is 2019. But all the numbers in the notice are for 2014 or prior. That makes them at least 5 years out of date. It's not accurate. It's not accurate as to the library board, our brand new library. You heard Mr. Watson's letter tonight. Seattle, if they had reached out to him, might have been able to have this all wrapped up. They didn't try. It's not complete, and it conflicts with information that Seattle is now telling us, the residents. Mr. Pittman was here in March. He said, don't worry about zoning. Don't worry about it. Not an issue. But when you look at the notice of intention, the zoning goes up considerably. Amanda gets her wish. We become another urban village. What does that mean in terms of the poverty, the increased poverty? That's really my concern. I think that they need to take a little bit of time, be serious about this, show respect to this community and respect for you, because I really feel like our best interests are not being considered here. And the best interests, particularly of the young people, are not being considered. And I really think it's in violation of ethics and morals and the Fair Housing Act. I think we need to stop thinking. Oh, by the way, last night the Housing Authority made some comments. I spoke to Jen Ramirez-Robson this morning. She confirmed that when she said 10% for the housing, she was only talking about public housing. That's people, I believe, at 30% and lower. There are hundreds of units of what they call workforce housing in Seattle. I have a map that I was provided by the Housing Authority, and I'll give it to you to look at. And I've also started a list of tax-exempt properties. It's not complete, but I think it will give you an idea of really how much poverty is here and how much people are suffering. It really, King County should be ashamed for even. failure to this community, and I don't think Seattle is ready to approve. Thank you very much.
Questions from board members?
Yeah.
Tiffany Mallon, Carol Swatter.
Hello, my name is Tiffany Mowat. I lived here for over 20 years. I have 211 South 103rd Street, Seattle, Washington. It's like right in behind my road parcels. I'm here in support for Seattle annexation of White Center because there are many services and programs that Seattle can bring to residents of White Center that could greatly help the family and the community here. For example, annexing Seattle would mean more services to our young children in the form of parent-child home visitor programs, nurse and family partnership programs, trauma-informed services, and additional support to our Head Start and Early Learners programs. For school-age kids, there would be potentially, or we could potentially have more after-school services and resources to support our local parks programming, which also impacts our youth. Currently, county services are extremely limited, as you've been informed by the county, and as a result, supports needed to ensure academic and social emotional well-being of our young children go unmet. Our business district needs support to strengthen the economic development and funds to support the growth and development of our local businesses. Without support to our local chamber and local businesses, we're unable to be competitive and keep up with the growing needs of retail and commercial businesses, not to mention supporting our small immigrant and refugee businesses. My executive director, Celie Sabusa, also a resident, couldn't be here tonight, but I know that she would tell you that for many of the 17,000 plus residents here in White Center, it's a question of quality of life. First and foremost, we want to do what's best for this community, and annexation would bring the supports that would complement and continue to build and support a rich and diverse population that deserves the best that any city can offer. We deserve annexation to Seattle because we care about White Center. Thank you.
Questions?
Are you affiliated with the particular group you mentioned, your executive director?
I work for the White Center CDA. We're here in this building, the Community Development Association, and the S Foundation of White Center.
Yeah,
definitely.
Sorry.
Harold Swaggers?
No. That's Scott. I thought that was a sign-in sheet.
Oh, it is 51 to
me. Is it?
So I'm sure I'll put that up. That's what the
signature is.
Hi, and I am Meryl Sinkman. I live at 205 South 102nd Street. And I was initially in favor of Seattle annexing us because I believe that perhaps we would get greater services for your police protection and the like. However, what I've seen going on Myers Way makes me change that view because I haven't seen any good faith effort by the city of Seattle to control the situation over there. I know others have mentioned it, but we have crime out in the open. We've got prostitution, we've got fencing of stolen goods, we've got open drug use, we have nothing's being done to rectify it. So, you know, if annexation is going to be seriously considered by the community, I think the city of Seattle should make a good faith effort to first clean up that situation and build some trust with the folks who are located along that area. The other concern I have is affordability of housing. The city of Seattle has some very onerous rules for landlords. They have to pay a fee for inspection, which will make rents go up. And it's very onerous also to evict a problem tenant. And that's problematic for landlords. So those are my two concerns, and thank you for your answers.
Questions from the board? Ms. Evans?
You said that the city placed the folks along Myers Way. Can you say some more about that?
Yeah, I think there's an Officer Whitkey, and I'm sorry if I got that name wrong, but those are leads, at least to my understanding, and I may be mistaken, but those are leads that are intentionally placed on the land that the city owns and upon which the parcels aren't being currently used. So those are these were placed there.
So you mean in terms of an encampment?
Yes. And they've been placed there, and now there's no enforcement of the law. So we got them, but we've got no services for them. I know that there's some dumpsters that have been put out there, but still the garbage piles up. And again, fencing is stolen goods, drug use, prostitution, people exposing themselves along the street. You know, we've got all of that.
Cole McLaughlin and Mark Upkiss.
Thank you for listening to me. My name is Paul McLaughlin. I've been born and raised here. I've been here 60 years. I feel that I should have been notified by mail, and I did not receive anything in my mail telling me. I had to wait for a neighbor to tell me that you're having a meeting. I believe that if we would have mailed it out to the residents, I'm a disabled vet. I don't use a computer. I don't think I've been represented properly or notified. I like our community. I think we should stay the way we are, King County. We're a very poor area. If Seattle takes us over, it's going to chase our seniors out of here that still own a home. We have very good affordable housing today. I own 5 rentals. And I have affordable housing. If you put me in the city, there won't be any more affordable housing. Right now, they're raising the rents $100 every 6 months. They're forcing them out of there. If you're going to get rid of our only affordable housing, I think we got a problem. There's nothing wrong with our sewer and our water district. I'm very happy with them. I just ask you to please send out so that the residents of this neighborhood would fill this room. I'm here at the last second. I think it's not right. I don't think we've been represented as a community or notified right. Please pay attention to local people. That's it.
Questions from the board?
Signed up with Mark. Oh, yes. I might not be the last because some of the things I say might just spike. That's happened before. My name is Mark Huffkes. I live in White Center. I've raised my family here. I've been here for 18 years. I live at 10735 22nd Avenue Southwest. My youngest child, Hank, just graduated from Evergreen. I'm speaking here on behalf of the White Center Homeowners Association. It's a group that was created back several years ago. We have, our members believe that if we're going to be, and many of our members don't want to be annexed, but we believe collectively that if we're going to be annexed, Seattle is a better option for us than Erie. Hank just just graduated from Evergreen. You had a choice to go to Vashon Island, where the population is 92% white, or you could go to Evergreen, where the population was not 92% white. It was just about the opposite. He struggled with that a little bit. We talked to Lois and I, and my wife and I just spoke yesterday. We convinced him he needed to get Evergreen a truck. It turned out to be one of the greatest experiences of our family's history. When he thrived there. He was treated with respect. And he's a white kid, little white kid, who thinks he knows everything. He was treated with so much respect. And every Friday night, when I would come home, our living room would be full of, it looked like the United Nations in our house. And I loved it. All I could think of was how blessed I was that I could give my kid that kind of experience at 16, 17, 18 years old. Lois is a public health nurse. You heard from her yesterday. She's been president of Highline Citizens for School. And we helped doorbell to get these two elementary schools here. And we've spent years working in the Highland School District, which, by the way, won't change. And I'd like to remind you that Bellevue has three school districts within the Bellevue boundary. You can have students with two different school districts in any city, no more. Patrick, his Eagle Scout project, my older boy who's heading up to medical school, was at the food bank. He built all those food bank areas where you could grow food. So food bank staff and the health department all grow food there. So my point is, we're involved, and we own a couple of rentals as well as our with some other family members who are part of this. But I think what I need to help you understand is a little bit about my involvement in the center. Dick Thurnow, this park is named after Dick Thurnow. Dick Thurnow and I got together years ago and started advocating for this park. In fact, the building we're in now was facing some opposition, and Dick and I went to dozens of meetings to ensure that this building was here because it was such a great investment in our park. What we did do, and we appreciate that the architects followed us, is we didn't want them to destroy the sledding hill that every winter when we have snow, hundreds of kids show up and sled down the hill. We made sure that this building did not disrupt that spot. I spent 4 years on the UAC. I was elected to the UAC the first time with 7 votes, and the second time with 3 votes. And I enjoyed it. I learned a lot on the UAC, but the challenge I had is the people on the UAC, which is one of our old neighborhood councils, they kept claiming that they were the electeds of the community. They aren't the electeds of the community because they have 20 or 30 people voted in the UAC meetings. They're trying to do good things. I appreciate that, but don't claim that you're an elected individual from the community. I spent 3 years as president of the White Center Chamber of Commerce. And at that time, the Chamber of Commerce was a failing organization. We had over 50 active members when I was done. One of the first things that I did is I found 5 business owners and community leaders from communities of color, and I put them on the board because the board was all black. The second thing we did is we partnered with the CDA, and we said, hey, we can work with the CDA to develop a combined strategy. And from that partnership, we which I don't believe the chamber even manages anymore, but they can correct me if I'm wrong. We had a website. We have all 250 White Center businesses listed there for free. That was one of the things we did. I was served from chamber president from 2010 to 2012. We met with the city of Seattle multiple times with the community planning, with economic development. They, in fact, provide us with grant resources. And one of the things we did collectively was we put in our new 5 welcome signs to White Center that have welcome in 50 different languages. Those are all things that the chamber used to do a lot of and haven't been involved with very much. We had an anti-graffiti campaign to put 17 murals in White Center and covered up all the graffiti and took that issue on ourselves because King County doesn't have the resources to help us solve these problems. We facilitated community meetings on homelessness and chronic alcoholism. We did a responsible sales program with all the businesses in White Center to say, look, one of the problems we have is chronic alcoholism on the streets of White Center. We have to quit selling high-octane fuel alcohol in the morning because they wake up in the morning, they want to get drunk again, they buy a 99-cent can of alcohol that has the equivalent of almost 6 beers, and then they're back at their problem. We also did an annual report to the Liquor Control Board where we went out and counted alcohol containers and tried to quantify the problem we had with chronic alcoholism and chronic homelessness in downtown White Center. The joke I was going to make is, all these problems people have mentioned about on the Seattle City Line, I'm glad we don't have them in White Center. Give me a break. Let me take you on the tour of the alley between 15th and 14th in downtown White Center. There's prostitutes there. There's drug dealing there. There's homeless people sleeping there. It's a mess. And we don't have any resources from King County to be able to solve or address those problems. Almost none. And graffiti, signs, we talked about, welcome sign. Okay. Number 2, the library. Have you seen our new library? We all got together on the Scoutmaster. We got our Boy Scouts. It was a vacant lot, and it was overgrown, and it was a mess. And we wanted to clear it out because people were camping back there. So we got the Boy Scouts. We cleared it out. We found six homeless camps. We removed 1,100 pounds of mostly alcohol-related trash, hypodermic needles. We cleared all this up, and then we told the library board, hey, this is a great location for the new library. You can get this site. It's owned by the state. You can get it for almost free. Now, some people in this audience were against locating the new library right across, in that vacant lot, that was a problem. They were against locating the library right across the street from an elementary school. And when we went and talked to the librarian and the staff at the elementary school, they were all, God, put the library there, we're going to love it. But some people in this room fought aggressively to move the library down to Burien. And in my view, they wanted to try to reignite and bring Burien back. Because two or three people tonight who complained the most about Seattle were people that really pushed hard for Burien annexation and they didn't get their way. Okay, ethics. One person mentioned no comment plan. Well, that individual never said a word at the hearings, the board, boundary review board hearings with Burien. When Burien was trying to annex, she never said a word about a comp plan for the city of Burien. They didn't have a comp plan, but nobody complained about Burien not doing all this work, at least from this group, because they wanted Burien annexation regardless. They don't like Seattle. They won't admit that, but they don't. I could go on forever, but what I want to talk about is the fire department. How many of you have heard of the Washington Survey and Ratings Bureau? I know that Mr. James Pohamas has, of course. He's your professional firefighter. The rest of you heard about that. It's an insurance industry that evaluates fire districts. What it does is the insurance industry says, we need to know how to quantify insurance rates for fire insurance rates. So we want to know how good fire departments are. And they give a score. Now, I called them today, and I asked them, what are the scores? I asked them for Fire District 2, which is in Burien. I asked them for Seattle's Fire District, and I asked them for North Highline's Fire District. Now, there's a little bit of contradiction here, but here's what they told me on the phone. That North Highline's Fire District classification is a 4. Seattle's classification is a 2, the highest you can get in the state. And what they do is I've got a list I'm going to provide to you. It has its protection class evaluation overview. It gives you the criteria that they use to evaluate fire. I've written some comments on that too. That's going to be submitted to your material. My point, and then Burien is a 3. My point is that anyone that suggests, Seattle has one of the best fire departments in the state. There's only 4 or 5 fire departments that provide services at the level and get the rating that Seattle has. And the reason for this is in January 5th, 1995. We had a tang warehouse fire, and 4 firefighters died in the community. And it was a tragedy, and it was difficult for the community. And in fact, one of those firefighters grew up attending Holy Family School right over here in White Center. So his family's part of our community. What came out of that was a commitment from the city of Seattle to provide the best fire service anywhere in the state to their citizens, and they've done that. And for some of the people in this room, they've made suggestions that Seattle hasn't done, the fire department can't do this, won't do that. We aren't sure what they're going to do. I can guarantee you that the Seattle Fire Department is going to address every one of these issues that they've brought up. I don't have one that they do. And we are going to get exceptional fire service. I have to talk on that for years, but I won't. I would rather have, I guess the question here is if you're going to have a crisis at your home, what you want is, I want as many professional firefighters in my yard protecting my family as I can and get that in Seattle. I was going to talk about Medic 1, but I won't talk about that. Fire district, professional crews. What I want to say is that Seattle will always have more resources for fire service and health and public safety. They will always have more training for their staff. They are the ones that created the advanced life support system, the ALS that we're arguing about, that we've only had for 2 weeks. Remember, some of you people didn't say, tell you, mentioned you, that for 15 years, our ALS response time is from CPAC, almost 15 minutes away. Nobody said anything about that. We've only had this new short time for a couple of weeks. So it's not like we're losing this service. We just got it. And Seattle will solve it. Better salaries for our fire. Did you know that our fire department, with 34 employees, gave our fire chief a $56,000 raise in one raise, so he was paid $200,000 a year, the highest paid fire chief. chief in the state, and managed 34 employees. He was paid $30,000 more than the fire chief in Seattle, who managed 1,300 employees. So all I'm saying is the fire districts have done a good job for us, but their issue, some of their leadership, their issues are about Burien. They're not about Seattle, and they're going to always expect you to they're always going to complain about every aspect of Seattle potential governance, and it's not fair.
Questions from the board?
I signed up to speak, but I waived my time yesterday, so I don't know.
Hello, I'm Carol Siverts. I live on Myers Way, so I'm a citizen and also representing the Top Hat Action Team, the newly regrouped, and also many of our neighbors. So I'm on the border, basically, but still an unincorporated King County. And we are watching and dealing with the homeless crisis and the RV encampments. And we've recently had to go down into the woods, and we've got the exhibits for that, some of that, you know, the photos that were entered in. I've gone before the city council recently and addressed this, and there's just a lot going on. I moved into this area. Well, I've lived here since 96 in the area, but Myers Way was 3 years ago. So any statistic or anything that happened more than 3 years ago, it's a different world. You know, it's changed. And I would even say 2 years. So I watched it just before the meetings that we had an RV breakdown in front of our house. And thank goodness I heard about Toad, but that's unusual. Usually we deal with that new neighbor for quite a while. And you've heard everything that everyone has said is true, and I would repeat that, but you heard it. There also was a man that was working on saving Ham Creek in Duwamish, John Beale, who passed away. And he was a naturalist, and so, you know, we'd like to see those waterways protected, and we have a lot of human waste and garbage and things like that that he would be horrified to see, and we are. So there's a lot that we could go into, and I'd like to do the positive thing and work towards things that are going to be solution-oriented, and that's what I'm dealing with the city council and the health and human resources and mental health and things like that. But I would say right now we, in our area, we would like to postpone any vote or even really proceedings on this until we know what we're signing up for, because this is not what we want, and it's pretty clear. It's probably a little bit different world a couple of blocks away in White Center, though I have issues with parking there and feeling safe, and just saw a lot of things going on just 2 days ago, so it goes on like that. There's a lot more, and I am concerned about the library, and like I said, everyone's covered a lot of the things, but I just also heard that the jungle is literally spilling out onto the freeway now, and the state patrol are having to deal with, I think it was 529 cases of people on the freeway. There's a story on the radio about it, and it used to be something like 52 or something. You know, it's quite a big increase, so we're dealing with a real epidemic, and we need to see that getting better. I would say let's postpone any voting and let's see some changes before then and get some new data.
Questions for us?
I just have a clarification. I don't think those photos that you mentioned were entered into the record.
I think she did.
They just were today.
We tried yesterday, but we made new ones because we need the big ones to take to city council. So you get the smaller version, but you have them. And there's so much more. Our neighbors on nextdoor.com we've really united through all the neighborhoods, not just our Myers Way, but we've got a lot of support all the way to South Park and all points that you've heard from. So.
Other questions?
We've heard from everybody on the speaker's list. Is there someone who has not spoken yet?
I actually signed up into my agenda and I thought public testimony had started until I came back to meeting.
I see. Okay. Have you been sworn in?
No. as an individual, but I can certainly get a letter from my board in support of this. I just want you to know that Seattle has a long and deep history of broken promises to annex portions of the city. Columbia City was annexed in 1907, and we still don't have sidewalks in many portions. We have children walking in the street because they can't walk in the ditches where sidewalks should be. In North Seattle, which was annexed approximately 50 years ago, same problem. Not all of their streets have sidewalks. I'm very concerned about Seattle's promise to you, to the White Center community of 50 officers. We have 110 actively working officers for 88,000 people in the South Precinct. That is completely out of proportion with what coverage we have. We have people waiting for 2 hours for a response on an active, ongoing burglary. People are in their house, they call 911, and no one responds because we don't have enough officers. Even when we get the additional 200, that's still not going to be at the staff level that our chief would like to see. And to be at a comparable level, if the White Center would only get 24 officers, not 50. We can't afford to lose our resources that we're lacking now. I heard someone speak about economic development. I invite you to just take a little trip down to Mill King, where light rail went in, and great promises were made to us about all the economic development that would go on. The only thing that's happened is property taxes have gone up. People have been squeezed out of their businesses. We lost 40 businesses that have not returned to Mill King. And if Seattle can't develop an area like that with mass transit going through it, what are they going to do for this community? I think that this community is far better off not being part of Seattle. Thank you.
Questions from the board?
That will close public testimony then, and we will move to rebuttal, excuse me, by the City of Seattle.
I'm going to call for a break. It's 8:25 p.m. and we've been going for an hour and 25 minutes. So